For about 20 years, something huge, something that defined economies for generations, just vanished. So today, we're going to be economic detectives. We're going to solve a really fascinating mystery.
So here's the big question, right? For 20 years, all the way up to 2021, inflation was just gone. Where did it go? I mean, think about it. Prices just stopped their crazy upward climb, not just in Israel, but all over the world. So what was going on? What massive forces were powerful enough to keep it in check for that long?
Okay, before we start digging for clues, we need to get one thing straight. We're talking about something called disinflation. Now, this is super important. It's not deflation. Deflation is when prices actually go down. Disinflation is different. It's when the rate of price increases slows way, way down. So prices are still going up, but just a tiny, stable, predictable bit. And trust me, compared to the chaos that came before, this was a massive change.
All right, so here's our game plan for cracking this case. First, we'll check out the scene of the crime, so to speak. Then we'll follow three huge sets of clues: global ones, government actions, and what was happening right here in Israel. And then we'll put it all together and solve this thing.
Okay, first up, let's rewind a bit and take a look at our crime scene. We need to understand the chaos that came before inflation disappeared to really get how big of a deal this was.
I mean, just look at this chart. The drop is absolutely staggering. Back in the early 90s, you're looking at inflation in Israel hitting almost 20% a year. Can you imagine? But then after the year 2000, boom, it just plummets. It settles into this super stable, narrow range of like 1 to 3%. This wasn't just a small adjustment. It was a complete and total transformation of the economy.
And you can imagine, that kind of volatility creates so much uncertainty. How do you plan for anything? For your business? For your family? It was incredibly tough. This quote here really says it all. An investor back then swayed like a reed in the wind. It just perfectly captures that feeling of instability. And that's what makes the two decades of calm that came next so, well, so unbelievable.
All right, let's get to our first big clue. It turns out, this whole disappearing act wasn't just happening in one place. Nope, it was being driven by these enormous global forces that were literally changing the entire world economy.
Clue number one is all about globalization. The biggest part of this? China. China and other huge developing countries burst onto the world stage. And just like that, you had hundreds of millions of new workers joining the global workforce.
And the effect of that? Well, it was huge. It had this massive downward pressure on prices. Suddenly, companies had access to this giant pool of cheaper labor. They could make things for way less than before. What does that mean for you? Cheaper stuff. Cheaper clothes, cheaper electronics, everything. And all that new global competition put a tight lid on prices across the board.
Now, at the very same time, it was another revolution happening. A technological one. We're talking about the explosion of the internet, personal computers, automation. It was completely changing the game for pretty much every business on the planet.
And this simple comparison just nails it, doesn't it? Think about farming. Back in the day, you needed a ton of workers with hand tools. Today, one person in a high-tech tractor can do the work of dozens. That's a mind-blowing leap in productivity. And that exact same story was playing out in industry after industry.
So yeah, the impact was felt everywhere. Communication got better, we had instant access to information, companies got way smarter about managing their inventory. It all boils down to this: businesses could do more with less. And all that efficiency, it meant lower costs for them, which, you guessed it, meant lower prices for us.
Okay, so we have these huge global forces, but that's not the whole story. Let's move on to our second big clue. This wasn't just about markets and tech doing their thing. Governments and central banks looked at the crazy inflation of the past and said never again. They decided to rewrite the rules of the economic game.
And maybe the most important new rule was this really powerful idea called anchoring inflation expectations. It sounds complicated, but the concept is actually pretty simple. It's almost a psychological trick. The idea was that if central banks could just convince everyone that inflation was going to be low, then people and businesses would act like it and, well, it would become true.
So that's what they did. Central banks, including right here in Israel, started setting a really clear public target for inflation. They'd say, our goal is to keep inflation in this narrow little box, say between 1 and 3%. And you know what? It worked. It became a self-fulfilling prophecy, because if everyone expects inflation to be low, then companies don't feel the need to jack up prices, and workers don't demand massive raises to keep up.
Now, this is really important. It did not happen overnight. Not even close. You can see from the timeline for Israel, it took a whole decade to get this right.
There was a lot of trial and error, a ton of political arguments, but they stuck with it. And finally, around the year 2000, it clicked. The target stabilized and became a core part of how the economy was managed.
The other half of this new government playbook was about something called fiscal rules. Basically, it's about putting the brakes on government spending because, let's be honest, that can be a huge driver of inflation if it's not kept in check.
So countries started passing actual laws to put limits on things like how big the budget deficit could be or how much total debt the country could have. You can think of them like guardrails for the economy. They were designed to force governments to be more responsible with their spending and to stop them from just printing money and pouring fuel on an inflationary fire.
Okay, so we've got our global clues and we've got our government clues. Now for the third and final piece of the puzzle. Let's zoom in and look at what was happening specifically in Israel, because there were some unique local factors that pushed prices down even more.
So yeah, Israel wasn't just along for the ride. The government really pushed to open up the economy to more competition, which is always good for prices. On top of that, the shekel got stronger, which meant anything imported got cheaper for everybody. And then you had a shift in society. Things like the famous cottage cheese protests created real public pressure on companies to think twice before raising prices.
And there you have it. We've gathered all our clues. We've looked at the global picture, at government policy, and at the local story here in Israel. I think it's time. Let's solve this thing.
So the verdict is in. It wasn't just one thing. There was no single culprit. The mystery of the missing inflation was solved by what you could call a perfect storm of forces, all pushing prices down. You had globalization and technology driving down costs from the outside. At the exact same time, you had smart government policies building a stable foundation from the inside. Inflation didn't just disappear by accident. It was pinned down by all these powerful forces working together.
So that cracks the case of the last 20 years. But we all know what's been happening lately. Inflation is back, and with a vengeance. And that leaves us with one last really big question, doesn't it? Were those two decades of calm just a fluke, a weird blip in history? Or have those powerful forces that held inflation down finally run out of steam? Well, that's a mystery for another time.